Welcome to the Savvy Ladies Wednesday Wisdom Webinar Series. My name is Lisa Ernst and I am the Executive Director of Savvy Ladies. Savvy Ladies is a not-for-profit organization that provides free financial education and resources to women. Before we get started, a reminder that we'll have a few minutes at the end of the presentation for your questions. Feel free to type your questions into the chat window. I am so pleased to introduce you to Allyson Skinner. Allyson is a financial specialist with National Financial Network. After working for over 6 years on the corporate side of a large insurance and financial services firm, in 2011, she chose to follow her passion for helping others. Based on her own personal experience, she has a genuine interest in helping women live a better financial life. Allyson takes a holistic approach to helping her clients to think and strategize about their finances by challenging traditional financial thinking. Allyson is a wife and mom to two small children and understands firsthand what many of us face in trying to manage a home and family. Welcome, Allyson, and I appreciate your time today for the Savvy Ladies community.
Thank you, Lisa and Savvy Ladies, for having me. I'm very happy to be here today. So the first thing I'd like to do before really getting into the presentation is just set some expectations and intentions for this this presentation. So first, this is not intended to be the end-all be-all of ideas and ways that one can save money. What it is intended to be is information on very real ways that every day women can save a little bit more money. And this may not all be new information, and it might be information that many of you have heard before, but sometimes when we hear information just a little bit differently, that's when we have that aha moment and it really clicks, sends home with us, and you know, we're able to make that change. Now, in terms of expectations, you should expect to get real easy suggestions to be able to save more and create a realistic budget. And for me, I expect you all to take at least one or two little nuggets that you've learned, maybe an aha moment, and implement them immediately within 48 hours. Because we all know that if we don't implement something new within 48 hours, we probably never will. We all have a lot going on in our lives. We have bills, rent, mortgage, groceries, student loans, childcare. The new iPhone 6 just came out. So with all of our monthly responsibilities, needs, and wants, how is it possible to save more money? We're going to start with something very basic and just explain the difference between an expense and savings. Now, I know it seems basic, but it is something that a lot of people maybe don't understand exactly. So the definition of an expense is when we send money out into the world with absolutely no expectation that it will ever, ever come back to us. Savings, on the other hand, is when we send money out into the world with a reasonable expectation that it will come back to us and hopefully with a few of its friends. Now, most people are led to believe that financial failure is caused by market fluctuations and poor rate of return. Now, while market fluctuation and poor rate of return are a factor in potential financial failure, it's not true that they cause it. And the fact is that financial failure is caused by lack of savings and poor savings rate and improper cash flow. So on this slide here, we have two charts. The left chart is somebody who is chasing rate of return, and the right side is somebody who is saving. Now, they both have the exact same lives, the exact same income, but the one person on the left is only saving about 5% of their annual income, which is actually higher than the average savings rate in America these days, from what I've been reading. The person on the left, on the other hand, is saving 15% of their annual income. Now, in order to save 15% of their income, they've maybe reduced their debt a little bit, found some money to save away on taxes, but they both actually have the exact same amount of money going to their lifestyle. And as you can see, the person who's chasing rate of return, they're getting about a 6% after-tax rate of return, manages to save over the course of 30 years, $753,000. Not too bad. The person on the right, however, is only getting a 1% rate of return on their 15% savings and manages to save close to $1 million. So there's a big difference there. Now let's talk about cash flow for a little bit. A lot of people don't really understand how cash flow works. Basically, it's money comes in and it goes out, and that's cash flow. Well, it's true and it's not true. When cash comes in, there's only four places that it can go, and they're four very distinct places. It can go to lifestyle, groceries, childcare, personal care, bills and utilities. It goes to savings. It goes to debt and taxes, debt including good debt, student loans, mortgage, as well as bad debt, credit cards. And protection. Protection will be all of your insurances, your health insurance, your car insurance, and wills, trusts, all those important legal protection documents. So most people that I meet and that I know have what I refer to as a reverse cash flow. What that means is that money comes in, and first it goes to lifestyle. They pay their cell phone bill, they buy some groceries, they pay their childcare bill. Then they pay off their credit card bills, their mortgage, their taxes. Then they maybe save a little bit, and then the rest goes to their protection costs. A proper cash flow is reversed. It starts with protection because we need to protect our most valuable assets, which are our health, our life, and our ability to earn an income. Then it should go to savings. I recommend for all of my clients 15 to 20% of their income. If they're not there yet, we work there slowly. Then we pay everybody else, debt and taxes. And then what's left should be our lifestyle. Now, some people think that that means that they're gonna have to cramp their lifestyle, but the fact of the matter is we shouldn't be living beyond our means. There's always room for lifestyle enhancements, but first we need to make sure that we're maintaining a proper cash flow. So maybe you're thinking, that all sounds great, but where do I find the money to save more? Well, the first thing we need to do is get organized. It's incredibly important to have a really good awareness of where your money's coming from and where it's going. So there's a lot of different tools you can use. There's online tools. You can use an Excel spreadsheet, a money tracking diary, and a lot of your credit cards and banks that you might already have tools just like this online. So once we know where our money's coming from, then we can go to the next place. And that's know your basic monthly expenses. And I don't mean just take a guess. I mean know what your basic monthly expenses are. Now, we all know that some bills fluctuate, so take an average of them, and then you'll have an idea over the course of a year how much we spend on basic monthly expenses. Another huge part of being organized is being organized mentally and understanding spending habits based on the facts. And when I say the facts, I mean looking at the spending habits. So going through our bank statements, our credit card statements, and seeing where we're really spending our money. We need to also spend consciously. Know the difference between a need and a want. So for example, a couple weeks ago, the new iPhone came out and I happened to be walking past a Verizon store and there was a line outside of people waiting to buy the new iPhone. And every single one of them, I might be exaggerating, but most of them were on a perfectly working iPhone 5. Did they really need the new iPhone or did they just want it and convince themselves that it was a need? Once we understand the difference between a need and a want, we'll start to spend our money a little bit more wisely. Another thing is to consider state of mind and emotional climate when making any purchase. Know if you're purchasing something because you need it or because you want it because you're in a bad mood and you want to cheer yourself up or because you're in a good mood and want to give yourself a gift. Also, with spending consciously is a big thing, and it's a big point that a lot of people don't think about. Spend the money you have, not the money you wish you had. That's credit cards. So one thing that I recommend to a lot of my clients, and I use myself at my house as well, my family, is saving up for goals. So if I know that my children's summer camp is going to cost me, say, $1,000 this summer, I'll save up that money starting in September so that by the time the summer comes, that $1,000, that summer camp is already paid for. I do the same thing with Christmas shopping too. I actually start saving for the next Christmas in January, right after Christmas is done. So how to pay yourself first? You need to create a budget. And I know it seems like it's a difficult thing to do, but it really can be quite simple. And more than just creating the budget, it's sticking to it. You can do a lot of different ways of creating a budget, but sticking to it is the important thing because we can create all the lists we want, but if we don't do anything about them, then it's not going to matter. Have a separate savings account. And when I say a separate savings account, I don't mean one that's linked to a checking account. Have one in a different bank if possible. There are a lot of different places you can do that. Capital One 360, which used to be ING Direct, is a great way. And Smarty Pig, that's something online sort of bank that where you can save for goals. Credit unions, anything you want to do, you can research different ways. But having that separate savings account makes it just a little harder to get that savings that you're putting in there. Create automatic transfers from checking to saving on each and every payday. The minute that paycheck hits the account, some of it should be going out into a savings account. And you can create those automatic transfers to savings accounts that aren't actually attached to your checking account as well. Save a little bit each day, even $2 or $3. It's going to add up. Another thing that is really helpful and that I've tried myself and have found successful is to use cash to better regulate your spending. When we're not walking around mindlessly swiping our debit cards, we have a better idea of how much we're spending and what we're doing with that money. The truth is, budgeting doesn't have to be frustrating. I know it seems like it does, but this all goes back to getting organized. So we already know our basic monthly expenses, and now we've written them down. You can use a lot of different ways to create a budget. You can use Excel templates. Some of them are very, very good, and I've provided some of them to my clients. You can use free online tools like mint.com or learnvest.com. All of my clients have access to the Living Balance Sheet, where you can actually aggregate your accounts and get a real-time idea of what you have and where it's going. Know your grocery budget and use cash for your grocery shopping weekly. When we try and do a big bulk grocery shopping, we tend to overspend. Keep your household budget separate from your grocery budget. We don't usually need to buy things such as household cleaners and laundry detergent on a weekly basis. So if those two budgets are intermingled, sometimes it can get confusing and we end up spending too much. Include your regular savings deposit into your budget and make it mandatory. People don't include their savings deposits into their budgets, then it goes back to saving whatever's left over. So now you may be thinking, well, that's all great, but where do I start? Saving starts with a decision to save more, and that's it. Just with any other decision that we have to make in life, when we're actually ready to do it and make the firm decision that we're gonna start, that's when we do it. There's a million people out there say, I'll start working out on Monday because it's easier to do it on a Monday. Or I have to start it on the first day of the month. Oh, but the first day of the month's a Wednesday, so I'll wait till next month. That's just a downward cycle of procrastination and putting things off. So once you're ready and you're motivated to make a change, you'll make the decision and you'll start doing it right then, right there. And you don't need to make sacrifices to save. Look at your spending and see where you can quote unquote trim some fat and it won't bother you. For example, some people, the idea of giving up that daily Starbucks might be just absolutely insane. They can't do it. But the idea of giving up getting lunch out at work is easy. So they can bring their lunch to work and save $10 and still have their daily Starbucks. It all comes down to choices. Know what you can give up or change in your life without feeling like you're sacrificing something or depriving yourself. Because if you feel like you're sacrificing and depriving yourself, you won't stick with the plan very long. And with each dollar you save, each dollar will grow. And here are some ways that you can lower your monthly expenses. I'm sure you've probably heard a lot of these before. And they're very simple, but they actually do work. Shop around for your car and homeowner's insurance. See if you're missing out on any discounts. Call your current provider and see if there's any new discounts that you might qualify for. Check for alumni association discounts. When a deal comes around, switch your cable provider and get rid of those premium channels if you don't need them, because $10 a month per channel is a lot of money, and that might be a place where it's more of a want than a need. Turn off lights you aren't using. I know it seems simple and it drives me nuts in my house that I often walk around turning lights off, but when we turn lights off and unplug appliances that aren't being used regularly, we actually do save quite a bit of money on our electric bills. Washing clothes in large loads with cold water, contact your credit card companies about lowering your interest rates. All of these things don't take too much time and can add up to like 50, 60, even a couple hundred dollars a month. So here are two very practical and simple challenges that I have done myself and that I've offered to a lot of my clients and have found it very useful. And it can help you, quote unquote, find the money to save. I call it ghost dollars. So the first is a 30-day grocery challenge. You figured out your grocery budget. And just so you know, for a family of four, it should be around $400. So now you know what your grocery budget is and what you're spending on your groceries. Make your list out each week, and each week, take out the cash for that week's groceries only. So if you know you need $100 a week, when you do your grocery shopping on Saturday or Sunday, take out that $100 and make sure that you try very, very hard not to spend more. Use a coupon book to track your receipts. You can get one of those anywhere. And instead of putting coupons in it, you put your receipts for the different stores that you go grocery shopping in. Now, I'm a little bit of a maniac, and I tend to know where the best deals at the best grocery store are, so I'll go to three grocery stores in a day. If that's not your cup of tea, that's fine, but that's one way of doing it without spending hours couponing. And you'll really find that at the end of the month, you've saved quite a bit of money. For my own family, for example, I found I was saving $200 to $300 a month on groceries just by being more conscious of what I was purchasing and each trip and knowing what I needed to spend. The second one is something that I call the 21-day savings challenge. It's something that I've done on Facebook and has been very successful for a lot of people. For 21 days, because it takes 21 days to build a habit, each day take $5 to $10 cash and put it in a vase or a jar. Now, if you're thinking $10, that's easy, sure, bump it up to $15 or $20. Or if the thought of $5 a day is too much, start with $3. It doesn't matter. The point is that every day you put the same amount of money away. And then don't touch the money for till 21 days are up. You'll literally be able to watch a pile of money grow. And just think, if it's only $5 a day, that's over $100 you just saved in 1 month. So before we get to the questions, I just would like to say that, you know, I really hope that this has been useful for you and you've gotten some good nuggets. And I'd also like to encourage you to seek out a financial professional. Now, it doesn't have to be me. This is not a plug to get you to work with me, but find somebody who you connect with, who you think can help you to better understand your money and how it works and what you need to do. Because when we have somebody else helping us and coaching us, it seems a little bit easier. We don't have to do this alone. So, you know, find somebody who you connect with, who you think can help you out. And once again, I'd like to thank Savvy Ladies for having me here today. And at this point, I'll take any questions that you have.
Wow, Allyson, that was really great. That was a lot of great practical information for our community. We have a couple questions that came in online, so let me get to those.
Okay.
The first one is from Susan. You mentioned some applications or online budgeting tools. Can you recommend one for someone who is not a super computer user?
For someone who is not a super computer user, I would probably do something like mint.com or learnvest.com. What you do with those is you can actually aggregate your accounts. And what that means is it's very simple. You go onto the website, you search for an account. So say you have a Chase bank account. You'd click Chase and you would type in your login and your username and password for Chase. And what that does is it gives Mint.com Chase permission to send your information to Mint.com. It's non-transactional, but what it'll do is it'll draw in all your information. So it'll pull in all your transactions, your current bank statement, and you can see what you're spending. And it'll also help you categorize them and create very simple budgets based on what it's seeing in your actual transactions from your bank accounts.
Great. This next question is from Joan. Is it more important time-wise to pay off debt or work on savings if it appears as though you cannot do both?
Savings, definitely. Now, that's not to say you should stop paying your debts. Definitely pay, but pay the minimum. The reason why is that if we don't have any money in savings and an emergency happens, say your tire blows on your car. It doesn't have to be a life-threatening emergency, but a tire on a car blows or you get into a minor fender bender, you're going to need cash to get those things fixed. And if you don't have it, you're going to need to put it on a credit card, just making the debt situation worse. So I would say start with savings while maintaining good credit by paying your minimum credit card balances. And as you've saved up at least a couple $1,000s, then maybe you can bump up those credit card payments and create some sort of plan to pay it off faster.
Great, great. This next question, what can you do if you're married or in a relationship and don't know where your partner's money is coming from or where it's going because you're uncomfortable asking or he likes to keep it to himself?
That's a difficult one. That goes into a bit more of the emotional side of money. I think what it comes down to is if he likes to keep it to himself, you need to express your feelings about that, because what if something happens to him and you don't know where the money is and you don't know the logins and passwords for any of it and he hasn't put that down anywhere and nobody else knows, then you could be stuck in a really difficult position. If you maybe put it like that, saying that I feel uncomfortable not knowing these things because what if something happens, what am I to do? And you take it, put it all about your feelings, then I think you'll find that he'll maybe be open to sharing it with you. And it's really important to have these open financial discussions in a relationship. I mean, I read statistics all the time that a lot of the reasons why relationships end up, you know, failing with divorce is because of money. And you don't want that to be your relationship, and it doesn't have to be if you just talk about it.
Great, great. I think that's it on the questions, Allyson. So I want to thank you again. This has really been a great session for the Savvy Ladies community. And I want to remind
helpful.
Everybody, I'm sure it was. It was helpful for me. So I want to thank everyone for attending today and remind you to go to the Savvy Ladies website at www.savvyladies.org to check out future webinars. Thanks again, Allyson.
No problem.